لا
عندنا نعمة خلالة كومباشن اللي مسمى سوى بليس بتاع الأسلام عليكم. ويلكم تو أبو باورجي لسون 5. أبو باورجي لسون 5 هو لسون تقريب من بي صفات الماموس. In our previous lesson we discussed about the endoskeleton. Importance of endoskeleton, the 8 points, remember them. We also did something to do with locomotion in fish and how fish is adapted in. What we said, the streamlined body, the scales that are pointed backward, the mucus that are secreted by the body of the fish, the inflexible head, presence of the swim bladder that enables the fish to provide the fish with buoyancy and also enables the fish to adjust its vertical position in relation to water depth. Remember presence of the lateral line that enables the fish to detect vibrations and changes in pressure and therefore make the fish to respond suitably. Good. Those are some of the things we said. Remember the paired and the unpaired fins and how they assist in the movement. And then calculation, tail power calculation, tail power calculation. I give you an exercise. Some of you did it. Others have called me and we solved it. Yeah. For those of you that we did not connect, this is it. Tail power, the formula we give, tail power is equal to tail length of a fish length times 100. In our equation, the tail length we were not given, but the fish length was 60 centimeters. But you were told that the length of the tail is a third that one of the fish, a third the length of the fish, and therefore it will be a third of 60 times 100. A third of 60 will be 20 centimeters. Remember, we said as an NB in our previous lesson, we said that the two length should have equal in you, should be equal in the unit. If the centimeter, then times 100. The unit drops with the unit, the zero goes with the zero by 2, 1 by 2, 3, this one times 100, therefore we end up having around 3.3, therefore around 3. It doesn't have a unit, because it is about comparison. We are comparing the length, of the tail with the length of the fish, and therefore we don't give it as a unit. Good. Thank you. Let's now start our lesson. That's what we were supposed to do in the calculation. Support in mammals. I would say in the skeleton mammals, endoskeleton, because what gives mammals support, is the endoskeleton. Now I'm saying endoskeleton in mammals is divided into two. That is one axial skeleton. We have axial skeleton, and two, we have appendicular skeleton. One after another. What do I mean by axial skeleton? This is axial skeleton. See, axial skeleton consists of the skull. It consists of the skull or the cranium, bones of the vertebral column, the rib cage, and sternum. What about appendicular skeleton? Good. Appendicular skeleton, the word appendages. Appendicular comes from the word appendages. Appendages. That means body extension. Appendages means body extension. And therefore, appendicular skeleton consists of a pelvic Guido or the pectoral Guido. The verb of the pectoral Guido and the falling. Pectoral Guido and falling. And then it's also a verb of the pelvic. The pelvic Guido. The pelvic Guido and the hindling. And the hindling. Good. And the skeleton in mammals. We are talking about support in mammals. What gives mammals support is the endoskeleton. Not hydroskeleton, not exoskeleton, but it's endoskeleton. And the skeleton in mammals, when I started teaching parts of the skeleton, parts, sometimes I give it this one another different subtopic called parts of the skeleton. Then we say endoskeleton in mammals is divided into two main parts. The skeleton is divided into two main parts. One, we have what the axial skeleton. Number two, we have appendicular skeleton. What is axial skeleton? What is appendicular skeleton? He said axial from the word axis. Consider this axis. Yes. My axis, for example, yes, along this length, if you consider, we have got this bone here that's covering the brain, the skull or the cranium. We start with this. This will now fall under the axial skeleton. So what falls under the axial skeleton, yes, is this, go through this, it is the bones of the neck, yes, those are generally the bones of the vertebral column that start immediately after the occipital bone, and then it goes downward, yes, it passes backward through here until the tail. That's what we call the backbone. So biologically we call it the vertebral column. That's also part of the axial skeleton. Then what comes under this axis also are the hip cage. The hip cage and the sternum. These are the ribs. A human being has got all of ribs on either side, all of on this side, all of on this side. The ribs at the back, they are held to the vertebral column. At the front, our ribs are connected to the sternum. And therefore, this bone here that is found within the, or between the two breasts is what we are calling sternum. So when we say axial skeleton, it is the skull, the vertebral column or the backbone, the hip cage, and then the neck, and then the sternum. What about the appendicular skeleton? Appendicular, the word appendicular is a Greek word and it comes from the word appendages that means body extension. Therefore, when I talk about appendicular skeleton, it consists of two main parts also. It consists of the pectoral girdle and the falling. When I say the pectoral girdle, I mean here the shoulder blade, here, the scapula, or then the clavicle. Yes, this one here, the clavicle. That is what I'm calling the pectoral girdle. And then the falling are these ones. These are what we are calling the falling. So the pelvic, the pectoral girdle and the falling. That's what constitutes the appendicular skeleton. And then the pelvic girdle here. Pelvic girdle here, we have got the bones here, we have two halves. One half of the pelvic girdle on this side, another half, the two halves are connected around the pubic symphysis by a tough cartilage. So the pelvic girdle and the hindlimb. So these are the girdles, and then the hindlimbs are the two legs and the bones that are found there, the femur, the tibia, the fibula, the tarsals, the metatarsals, and the phalanges. That's what it's all about. So I will tackle first, I will start with axial skeleton, and axial skeleton, we'll discuss the skull. After we are done with the skull, the ribcage and the sternum, and then we do the vertebral column. When we are done with this bit again, we'll move to appendicular skeleton. In our lesson today, I will start with axial skeleton. I will start with axial skeleton. Yeah. The axial skeleton, as I said before, it consists of the skull. I said that before. So, under the axial skeleton, I will discuss the skull. So, call it the cranium. Yes? The skull is that big bone, that bony structure that covers our head and protects the brain.
So when I'm talking about the skull, what is the skull made up of? The skull consists, or the skull is made up of the cranium fused. The cranium fused or joints, cranium fused to the upper jaw, cranium fused to the upper jaw, lower jaw, cranium fused to the upper jaw and the lower jaw. Yes, it is this cranium attached or fused to the lower jaw and then the upper, and then the upper jaw, that's what consists of the skull. What's the function of the skull? The function of the skull, cranium, is to protect. Is to protect the brain. Not only the brain, it also provides protection. It also provides protection to the eye, ear, and muscle, the nasal cavity, and the nasal cavity. Yes. Basically, it is about protection. The skull provides protection to the brain. Brain is a delicate nervous organ, and therefore it has to be protected. It further provides protection to the eye, to the ear, and to the nasal cavity. To provide the protection required, if something is to give protection, itself must be rigid. That structure itself must be firm, so that it can be able to bear. It can be able to bear with damages, the physical damages and mechanical injuries, before it finally reaches those particular organs. So, to provide protection, the skull is firm and rigid. The skull is firm and rigid. Yes. And what is this skull made of? Yes? What is this skull made of? Or the cranium is this cranium? Yes? One may think the skull is one solid bone. No. The skull, if you have ever came across a skull, you may think it is one solid bone, but we say the skull is made up of small bones that are joined to one another at a fixed or at an immovable joint that are called suchas. Suchas. Yes? The skull is made up of small bones that are joined at a fixed or immovable. These small bones that are making the skull are fused. They are fused and they fix or they join at a fixed or immovable joints. The joint where two or more bones meet. Yes? When we're defining joint, we say a joint is where two or more bones meet. We will come to joints as a subtopic and we'll discuss it in detail and in depth. The skull is made up of small bones that join at a fixed or immovable joints called suchas. Yes? My high school teacher will say it, such as, but my professor in the university will pronounce this as sutures. Sutures. So, it's up to you to decide which one. For me, I decided the first come, first time. Yes, so I have taken the pronunciation of my secondary teacher. So, such as. Yes. You can pretend to be a professor and therefore call it sutures as well. So the skull is made up of small bones that join at a fixed or immovable joint. Fixed or immovable joints means it will not. We have two bones joining. So at this point where I'm calling joint, it will not allow any movement. That's why I'm calling a fixed joint or an immovable joint. It will not allow any movement. And that is why the skull is one solid bone. The small bones will not move. That was called sutures. The skull has perforations. The skull has depressions. Has depressions that accommodate sense organs. Depressions that accommodate sense organs.
sense organs, e.g. ear and eye, to protect them against physical damage, to protect or to provide protection against the physical damage. If you have seen a skull has got some holes, yes? Some of those holes, even your hand can fit. What are those holes? Those are the positions where the eye was contained in. That hole you are seeing is the position where the ear was in. So when the organism decomposes and it finally disappears completely, then whatever remains are bones. So from the skull, you can tell the position of the eye because it is empty. You can tell the position of the ears because the ear has been decomposed and eaten up by decomposers. Those are the bacteria, the fungi, and therefore they end up being holes. Because I'm saying skull has depressions. This depression is for what? This depression is to accommodate sense organs, i.e. is to accommodate the ear, to accommodate the eye, so that it provides protection to the eye and to the ear against the physical damage and mechanical injury. Some may tell, Malinus, our ear is here outside. What you are seeing here is not an ear. The human ear has got three parts: the outer ear, the middle ear, and the inner ear. Whatever you are seeing here is only part of the outer ear. This one, the ear pinna, is the ear pinna, and the external auditory meatus are collectively called the outer ear. And then we have got the middle ear, that's made up of the tympanic membrane or the eardrum. It's made up of the milius, the incus, the steps, the oval window, the long window, and the eustachian tube. We also have the inner ear. The inner ear consists of canals, a system of canals and flues. Yes, and also membranes. We have the tympanic, the resinous membrane. We have the tectorial membrane. Yes, we have some flues, the perilymph and the endolymph. Something like that. This is the vestibular apparatus, remember, the mesocular canals. All those are found within into the skull. That's why we say provides protection against the physical damage. Also, on the skull, we have small holes that we call perforations. Yes, the perforations in the skull are pathways to blood vessels. Pathways to blood vessels and nerve fibers in and out of the brain. Pathways to blood vessels and nerve fibers moving in and out of the brain. Moving in and out of the brain. Yes, if you see a skull and then you give it a close look, you will realize that. I talk of depression. These are not depressions. They are tiny holes, just very tiny holes. Good. Those tiny holes is what I'm calling perforations. These are now a passage of blood vessels, passage for nerve fibers moving into the brain and out of the brain. But there is big perforation. There is a very big perforation at the end of the, or at the back of the skull. The big perforation at the back of the skull, and I call that foramen magnum. I call that foramen magnum. At the end of the skull, the main bone that is found at the back of the skull, we call it the occipital bone. Occipital bone. Yes, at the back of the occipital bone, we have got a big perforation or a big hole that we are calling foramen magnum. What's that? The foramen magnum is an entry point of the spinal cord to the brain. At the back is the entry point. Is the entry point of the spinal cord. Spinal cord to the brain. You know the spinal cord is the posterior extension of the brain, and therefore, where the spinal cord enters the brain is what we are calling the foramen magnum. And then lastly, at the back
of the skull, we have two round surfaces that are called corneals. Two round, the corneals fit into the first bone of the cervical vertebrae, into the atlas, to allow nodding movement. See, when you are nodding your head, where does that movement occur? That movement occurs at the junction or at the joint formed by the skull together with the atlas. Together with the atlas. The technique after that is just a one line. Yeah, I'm saying that the two round surfaces, the two round surfaces at the back of the skull, the two round surfaces at the back of the skull, we call this corneals. We call this corneals. The two round surfaces at the back of the skull or the corneals is to fit into the first bone, is to fit into the first bone of the vertebral column, first bone of the vertebral column. And what is the first bone of the vertebral column? That's the atlas. The atlas. It fits into the first bone of the vertebral column, atlas, allowing for nodding movement. Allowing for nodding movement. When you are nodding, you see, immediately after the skull, the vertebral bones start. The first bone of the vertebral bone is the atlas. So the atlas and the skull, they fit into one another to, and then they articulate to allow some kind of movement. And therefore, this tour, it was good I show you, and inshallah in the next lesson I will try to come up. Though my fear is schools are closed, and that's my source of resources. Schools are polluted, but if possible, I will look for the human skeleton, I will look for this particular bones, the skull, and then practically, we will show the sutures, we will show the impressions, we will show the perforations, and then we will also see the foramen, the foramen magnum, and then we can be able to see the corneals. And then we see that corneal is to fit into the first bone of the atlas, the first bone of the vertebral column, into the atlas, and again, allowing for nodding movement. So I will stop here for this particular lesson. In the next lesson, we will learn about the rib cage and the stomach. Thank you. Thank you for your attention.